بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. إن شاء الله تعالى, the topic that I will be speaking about is the virtue of knowledge. بإذن الله الكريم. My beloved brothers and sisters, before I start talking about the topic at hand, I first wanted to say, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward the brothers who invited me. Because the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in the hadith al-Imam Ahmad narrated in his Musnad, Abu Dawood in his Sunan, and Imam al-Bukhari narrated in his kitab Adab al-Mufrad, and Sheikh Muhammad Nasiruddin al-Albani authenticated this hadith, لا يشكر الله من لا يشكر الناس, that the person who does not show gratitude to the people has not shown gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the brothers who invited me and brought me over, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward them and forgive them for any shortcomings and mistakes that they've ever come with. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he praised the Qur'an. Allah praised knowledge. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in many verses, he has spoken highly of what knowledge is. Ibn al-Qayyim, he wrote a book called Miftahu Dari Sa'adah. And this book, Miftahu Dari Sa'adah, is a book where Ibn al-Qayyim wants to speak about two things. Two things. The first thing that Ibn al-Qayyim wants to speak about is virtue of knowledge. And what Ibn al-Qayyim does is he mentions 153 virtues of knowledge. The fada'il of ilm, 153. After Ibn al-Qayyim finishes mentioning the virtues of knowledge, he goes and speaks about the concept of irada, having a drive and a motive. And Ibn al-Qayyim summarized it in one word. He said that every salik, every person who wants to transcend and grow and move, two things is what he needs. The first, he said, is himmatun turaqih, aspiration that lifts him. And the second, he says, is what? Ilmun yubassiruhu wa yahdi, knowledge that guides him. So there's no individual you see, except those two is what's making him do things. He has knowledge of what he's doing, and he's also driven. وَلِذَلِكَ those two are what we ask Allah to allow us to have in Surah Al-Fatiha. When we say, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ, oh Allah, guide us on the straight path. The path that's straight is a path that has combined between what? هِمَّةٌ تُرَقِيه وَعِلْمٌ يُبَصِّرُهُ وَيَهْدِيهِ. Because Allah tells us in that verse, غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. And the مغضوب عليهم are who? The مغضوب عليهم are the Yahud. And ضالين are who? What is it that the Yahud fell short on? They had علم. But did they have همة ترقي? No, they didn't. What about the Nasara? They had همة, aspiration. They had implementation. But what was missing from them? Ilm, knowledge. لذلك, the person, he wants to combine and gather between these two. So I'm not going to be speaking about in this lecture himma and aspiration per se. What I'm going to be speaking about is knowledge. Allah says in the Quran subhanahu wa ta'ala, قُلْ هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. And according to the scholars of grammar, they say this is called istifhamun bima'na nafi. And I'm not going to be too technical. Allah here is saying, قُلْ, ask them, Muhammad. قُلْ هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ. Are they? It's a question. This is called istifham. It's called istifham, in question. But the intent behind the istifham is already a negation. Allah is already negating it. Meaning, Allah is trying to say, أي لا يستوي الذين يعلمون والذين لا يعلمون. They are not the same. The ones who know and the ones who don't know. They're not the same. The reason why they're not the same is شرعاً and عقلاً, they're not the same. In the Sharia, are they both the same? Impossible. And in aql-wise, do you see the same? A person who knows and a person who doesn't know, do you see them the same? No, you don't. Ali ibn Abi Talib summarized this and he said, كَفَى بِالْعِلْمِ شَرَفًا أَن يَدَّعِيهِ مَنْ لَا يُحْسِنُ. To show you how high knowledge is and great, aqlan, is that everybody here, if I ever said to you, you are an alim, you'll be happy. It'll put a smile on your face. You sit up properly and say, yeah, that's me. Allahu Akbar. هَكَذَا خَلَقَنِ اللَّهِ. This is how Allah created me. صح? But if I called you the opposite of knowledge and I said that you're jahil, you don't know, what will happen? The opposite. You'll be very angry and you start fighting back, even if you are ignorant. So no one likes to be referred to as ignorant, and everybody likes to be referred to as a person of knowledge. And that is enough to tell you how high knowledge is. Ibn al-Qayyim, in his book that I mentioned, Miftahu Dari Sa'ada, when he stated 153 virtues, guess what virtue, which ayah he started with? This ayah that I'm going to mention now, which is شَهِدَ اللَّهُ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ وَأُولُو الْعِلْمِ قَائِمًا بِالْقِسْطِ. Here Allah says, شَهِدَ اللَّهُ. We have three things in this ayah that Ibn al-Qayyim mentions. أَجَلُّ شَاهِدْ وَأَجَلُّ مَشْهُودٍ بِهِ وَأَجَلُّ شَهَادَةٍ. This ayah says three things that are noble. Let's look at the ayah. شَهِدَ اللَّهُ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ. Allah testifies. رَبُّ الْأَرْضِ وَالسَّمَاءِ. He testifies, he bears witness to what? That there is none worthy of worship except Allah. Allah is the first one who testifies to that. Then Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَأُولُو الْعِلْمِ قَائِمًا بِالْقِسْطِ. After the angels, شَهِدَ اللَّهُ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ وَأُولُو الْعِلْمِ. Allah mentions the angels and then he mentions after that who? أُولُو الْعِلْمِ. Allah used the scholars as a witness that even they testify that there's none worthy of worship except me. And Allah would not use them if they are not mahallu thiqa, if they're not reliable. وَلِذَلِكَ the scholars, they have a tazkiyah from Allah. وَلِذَلِكَ some of the ulama authenticated the hadith ibn Abdul Barr, mentioned in his kitab جَمْعُ بَيَانِ الْعِلْمِ وَفَضْلِهِ يَحْمِلُ هَذَا الْعِلْمَ مِنْ كُلِّ خَلَفٍ عُدُولُهُ يَنْفَوْنَ عَنْهُ التَّحْرِيفِ الْغَالِينَ وَانْتِحَارُ الْمُبْطِلِينَ وَتَأْوِيلِ الْجَاهِلِينَ. Some of the scholars authenticated this hadith, even though chain-wise is weak, they use this ayah as a witness for it. And they said, this ayah is a shahid for it. It strengthens this narration. What's this narration? This narration says, يَحْمِلُ هَذَا الْعِلْمِ. This knowledge, do you know who's going to carry it? Udul. Do you know who udul are? Reliable people. Like people who have high integrity. So Allah is saying that the scholars are udul. The Prophet is saying that and Allah is saying it here. So they strengthened that narration based on the ayah and the hadith. The ulama have a tazkiyah from Allah. You know when you want to go to Medina University, you ask for a tazkiyah, you say, Sheikh, can you make me a tazkiyah? The ulama have it from Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is nothing, my beloved brothers and sisters, that the messenger was commanded to ask Allah to increase him in more than knowledge. وَقُلْ أَمَا قُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا قُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا أَوْ اللَّهِ أَمَا وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي علما. Oh Allah, increase me in what? Knowledge. ولذلك the ayah has a powerful meaning. Nowhere in the Quran did Allah tell the Prophet to say, increase me in dunya, or in wives, or in children, or in just knowledge. And you all know that the first verse that came down in the Quran is what? What was the first ayah that came down? Iqra, read. So we're a nation who reads. We're a people who give importance to knowledge and give understanding to knowledge. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He specifically, exclusively restricted the scholars to only have attained khashya and no one else. He says subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَى. That the ones who have attained khashya are only the ulama. And this word that Allah used, which is innama yakhsha Allaha min ibadihi al-ulama'u. Allah is maf'ulun bih. It's an object. The object has come before the subject. The object, which is the maf'ulun bih, has come before the fa'il, which is the subject. And the reason I'm telling you this is because this is where the exclusivity comes. Allah is trying to say that there is no one who has attained khashya except the ulama. Now, if I ask one of you guys, what's the definition of khashya, what would you say? Fear, right? That's an incorrect translation. Even I said it, but that's the only translation we could use. What about khawf? Fear. So what's the difference between khashya and khawf in translation? Abu Taymiyyah is your translator lately. I've been seeing it on YouTube. He's the one who translates for the mashayikh when they come. Yeah? So, khashya, the difference between khashya and khawf is what? Khashya is fear with knowledge. Ah. Khashya means fear ma'al ilm. Al-khawf ma'al ilm. But khawf doesn't have ilm with it. Are you with me? As Imam al-Qarafi mentions Kitab al-Furuq. Brothers, many people, because they don't have knowledge, they do mistakes in their religion. And mistakes that can't be tolerated due to ignorance. A man entered the Prophet ﷺ's masjid and he prayed. And he came to give the Prophet salam. And then he said, salam alaikum. And then the Prophet said to him, irja, fasalli fa innaka lam tusalli. Go back and pray, for you have not prayed. The man, he went, he prayed, he came back. He said, salam alaikum. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, irja, fasalli fa innaka lam tusalli. Kept telling him to go back. Until the man came to the Prophet. And he said, walladhi ba'athaka bil haqqi nabiyya, ma uhsinu ghayra hadha fa'allimni. The man came to the Prophet and he said to the Prophet, وَالَّذِي بَعَثَكَ بِالْحَقِّ نَبِيًّا, I swear by the Lord who has sent you out as a messenger, as a prophet, مَا أُحْسِنُ غَيْرَ هَذَا, I can't perfect a prayer more than that. فَعَلِّمْنِي, teach me, educate me. And then the Prophet ﷺ taught him how to pray. What was the problem that this man had? Jahl, ignorance. So the person has to make sure that they lift ignorance from themselves, that they learn, that they educate themselves, and they come to the hilaq, the circles that are being taught, ilm is being taught. Come and learn. وَلِذَلِكَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he praised Hudhud in the Qur'an because he had knowledge. وَلِذَلِكَ Sulaiman, he only left the killing of the Hudhud. You guys know Hudhud, right? It's the bird. What did Sulaiman say? مَا لِيَ لَا أَرَى الْهُدْهُدَ أَمْ كَانَ مِنَ الْغَائِبِينَ لَأُعَذِّبَنَّهُ عَذَابًا شَدِيدًا أَوْ لَأَذْبَحَنَّهُ أَوْ لَيَأْتِيَنِّي بِسُلْطَانٍ مُبِينٍ. I'm going to kill this bird. But it has to come with me, unless it comes with me what? أَوْ لَأَذْبَحَنَّهُ أَوْ لَيَأْتِيَنِّي بِسُلْطَانٍ مُبِينٍ. What's the sultanin mubin he's looking for? Ibn Abbas said that wherever the word sultan comes in the Quran, it means hujjah. This is called the qa'ida kulliya muttarida. It's a qa'ida you need to memorize. Wherever you read the word sultan in the Quran, it means hujjah, according to Ibn Abbas. So what does Hudhud have to come with for it to be saved from killing? Yeah? Hujjah. What's the hujjah here? Ilm. Knowledge. So what did she say when Hudhud came? When the Hudhud came, it said to Sulaiman, what is it that he said to Sulaiman? Huh? What did it say to Sulaiman? Huh? Brothers, it's not a rhetorical question, it's a direct question. I want an answer. What did it say specifically? أَحَطُّ بِمَا لَمْ تُحِطْ بِهِ وَجِئْتُكَ مِنْ شَيْءٍ بِسَبَئٍ يَقِينٍ. وَجُؤْتُكَ, I have come to you. أَحَطُّ بِمَا لَمْ تُحِطْ بِي, I've gained a knowledge in a matter which you, Sulaiman, haven't gained. وَلِذَلِكَ Ibn al-Qayyim mentions a story. Ibn al-Qayyim mentions in Kitab Miftah Dari Sa'ada that a teacher was one day asked a question. A teacher was asked a question and the student was sitting there when he was asked a question. So the teacher didn't have the answer to the question. the teacher didn't have the answer to the question. The teacher didn't know. So he said, La adri. Brothers, La adri is nisful ilm, right? When you say, I don't know, it's half of knowledge, right? So if you say La adri twice, you've got full knowledge. Yeah? La adri is half of knowledge, right? So say La adri twice. Let's all say it now. La adri, La adri. Does that mean if we do mu'akasa, that means we've got full knowledge? No, what it means is that once you say La adri, you're going to go and you're going to seek knowledge. As they say, a good dream is half the bottle. Sah? When you dream, you've come with half of the effort, all you just need to do is achieve the next half. When you say, I don't know, you will then go and seek. But if you're in a state of denial, you believe you know, you're not going to seek knowledge, are you? That's what it means, La adri. Anyways, the teacher said, La adri. He said, La adri. The scholars, they say, among a person who doesn't say, La adri, usibat maqatilu. Usibat maqatilu. If you don't say, La adri, you're going to be destroyed. Anyways, the teacher said, La adri. The student stood up and he gave an answer. Broke the mas'ala down. And he said, I know. And he answered the question. When he answered the question, the teacher got angry. How could you answer a question? I said, La adri. I don't know. And you come and you answer it. And he said to his teacher, you are not better than Sulaiman, and I am not lower than Hudhud. Hudhud said to Sulaiman, أحط بما لم تحط به وجئتك من شيء بسبأ يقين وجئتك بسبأ وجئتك من سبأ بنبأ يقين. أحط بما لم تحط به. I have encompassed and I have gained an understanding and knowledge of a matter which you haven't. And this, the scholars, they say, is called tafdhil muqayyad. That sometimes the teacher may not know a mas'ala and that the student knows. It's called tafdhil muqayyad. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in the hadith, Imam al-Bukhari narrated in his sahih min hadithi, Uthman ibn Affan radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, khayrukum man ta'allama al-Qur'ana wa 'allama. The best amongst you is what? The one who learns the Qur'an and he teaches it. The Qur'an is the significance of the Qur'an is because it's ilm. So the best amongst you, whoever learns the ilm of the Qur'an. In the Arabic language, brothers, the word khayr, it used to be akhyar. Akhyar. Like in suqitat al-alif, the alif was dropped because of the excessive usage of the word. So now we don't say akhyar anymore, we just say khayr. When the Arabic language, the word comes in af'al, in this form, akhyar, what does it mean? It's superlative. It means that this is the highest. Like, for example, you say tawil, atwal. Qasir, aqsar. Are you with me, brothers? Tawil means tall. Atwal means tallest. Khair here means the best. The best. Khairakum. Man ta'allama al-Qur'ana, the one who learns the Qur'an wa'allama. Some people thought now, what it means that learning the Qur'an, they thought it meant just the wordings. And that's not the case. Ibn al-Qayyim mentions in his kitab, Miftahu Dari Sa'ada, it means learning the wording and learning the meaning and teaching it. That the person learns the huruf, يُقِيمُونَ حُرُوفَ. They learn the huruf, the wording. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Good. What does waladina amanu mean? You can read like husari, good, no problem. Like, what does it mean? Yeah. So you have the huruf and you have the ma'ani with you. Ya ikhwa, sah? So the khayrakum man ta'allama al-Qur'an wa 'allama. Walidhalika Abdurrahman, Abu Abdurrahman al-Sulami, the student of Uthman ibn Affan, he said, ma aq'adani fi maq'adi hadha. 60 years he sat in Kufa. 60 years. And by the way, he's the one who narrated this hadith from Uthman ibn Affan. If you look at the Sanad, all the riwayat go back to him. Abu Abdurrahman al-Sulami, his name is Abdullah ibn Habib. Abdullah ibn Habib. He said, this chair I'm sitting in, 60 years he was teaching the Quran. Guess who he taught the Quran to? Hassan al-Hussein. He's a tabi'i. He taught Hassan al-Hussein the Quran. His name is Abu Abdurrahman al-Sulami, Abdullah ibn Habib. And then he said, ما أقعدني في مقعدي هذا. Nothing made me sit in this seat I'm sitting for 60 years in Kufa to teach the Quran. Nothing else made me it except the hadith I heard from Uthman, that he heard from the messenger, that the best amongst you is the one who learns the Quran and teaches the Quran. And as you know, brothers, فضل كلام الله the virtue of the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ala sa'iri al-kalami kafadli Allahi ala khalqihi. Allah's speech is the highest of all speeches, right? From all the speeches of the people. The way Allah is higher than His creation, His speech is higher than the creation speech. So sometimes you see a student of knowledge, he's memorizing mutun. He's memorizing a book written by a scholar, but he hasn't memorized the Quran. And this is the kalam, the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It takes precedence over everything. If you're going to memorize something, first start with the Quran. Because there's nothing more virtuous than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's kalam. Also, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Al-ulama warathatul anbiya. The hadith of Abu Darda, fi Musnad Imam Ahmad, من سلك طريقا يلتمس فيه علما سهل الله له طريقا إلى آخر الحديث. The part of the hadith that concerns me here is وَإِنَّ الْعُلَمَاءُ وَرَثَةُ الْأَنْبِيَاءُ, that the scholars are the inheritors. وَإِنَّ الْعُلَمَاءُ وَرَثَةُ الْأَنْبِيَاءُ, they are the inheritors of the Prophet. Right now, brothers, what is it that we're doing right now? It's a circle of knowledge, benefits and knowledge is being given. We're sharing amongst ourselves the Prophet's inheritance. Are you with me? Would any one of you here be absent from your father's inheritance? If your father died and there was a gathering in which your father's inheritance was being given and it was being divided, would you be absent from it? ولذلك Abu Huraira, he used to stand outside the masjid and he would say to the people outside, أيها القوم, people, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would say, inheritance is being given out. The Prophet's inheritance is being given out in the masjid. So people come running. They come. Look, Ya Aba Huraira, what is it you're talking about? Nothing's been given out. And he said, what did you see? They said, we saw circles of knowledge, people just studying Quran here, this halaqa there, halaqa that. And he said, that's the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's inheritance. So pay attention, brothers. What is it that the scholars inherit from the Prophet? Yeah? Ilm, knowledge. Some people, my beloved brothers and sisters, have fallen short in this matter. They only thought that the scholars inherit from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam a knowledge. And that's not only it. They even inherit from the prophets the rights, the huquq that the anbiya have. They get part of that huquq. They inherit it. Are you with me, brothers? Ibn al-Qayyim mentions this. That you can't disrespect a scholar. A person who's carrying knowledge, the rights that he has inherited from the prophets is that you respect him. You honor him. The poet, he said, إِذَا أَفَادَكَ إِنسَانٌ بِفَائِدَةٍ, if a person benefits you a benefit, and you learn something from him, مِنَ الْعُلُومِ فَأَكْثِرْ أَمَ فَأَدْمِنْ شُكْرَهُ أَبَدًا. Both ways is narrated, it's brought together. فَأَكْثِرْ شُكْرَهُ أَبَدًا. Always have gratitude towards that person. وَقُلْ فُلَانٌ جَزَاهُ اللَّهُ صَالِحَةً أَفَادَنِيهَا وَأَلْقِ الْكِبْرَ وَالْحَسَدَ. And always say, this person has benefited me a lot. He has what? He has benefited me a lot. And get rid of arrogance and jealousy. Today what you see, brothers, is you're in this city. You have brothers who are teaching you guys. You have Abu Taymiyyah. You have other talabatul ilm, mashayikh, who come over and they're here to teach you guys and benefit you guys. A person will take benefits. They will learn. They'll be in that circle. They'll take notes. And when they learn, what happens? The person who taught you, who benefited you, who allowed you to know a lot of masa'il and a lot of matters, Shaykh Abdul Basit as well, who have taught you all these things, what do? You turn the table on him. Instead of showing and expressing what? Showing gratitude and saying, Jazakallahu khayran. Alidhalika of the poet, he said, أُعَلِّمُهُ الرِّمَايَةَ كُلَّ يَوْمٍ. Every day I teach him archery. فَلَمَّا اشْتَدَّ سَاعِدُهُ رَمَانِي. But when he became tough, every day I'm teaching him how to use the archery. I'm like, put your hand up. Are you straight? Yep, get it, pull it. Have you pulled it? Let it go now. Dude, yeah. And I teach him. When he learned how to do the archery, he turned it on me and he started throwing the arrows at me. This is what the poet said. وَكَمْ عَلَّمْتُ and how long was I teaching him? نَظْمَ الْقَوَافِ. I was teaching him how to write poetry. فَلَمَّا قَالَ قَافِيَةً هَجَانِي. And when he constructed the first poetry, guess who he directed it at? He directed it at me. The person who taught him it. And this is the reality of so many students of knowledge. How are you going to learn knowledge? How are you going to reach somewhere if the person who taught you how to know the difference between ba and ta. The person who taught you it, when you learnt it, you now throw your throw everything at him. You're never. And wallahi, many people, what happened to them, hirmanul ilm, knowledge has become prevented from them, is because they didn't express and show respect to those who taught them. I'm going to finally conclude by saying and mentioning, what is it that allows a person to become knowledgeable? What allows a person to become a strong student of knowledge? How can one attain knowledge? There's a poet who combined things that allows a person. He said, first of all, brothers, as you know, knowledge is too big and it's vast. And you will never ever be able to get to the bottom of it. أَعْطِ الْعِلْمَ كُلَّكْ. Give everything you have to knowledge. Money, wealth, you lose everything. And knowledge will do what? When it sees you going after, giving everything, say, you know what, I feel sorry for you. It give you something in return. Knowledge will give you something in return. Not everything. Are you with me, brothers? But you have to give everything. Your wealth, your children. Well, like some of the Salaf, people would come up to them and say, I want to become ulama al-hadith, I want to study this, and they will say to them, أَبْشِرْ بِالْفَقْرِ لَا يُفَارِقُكْ. Glad tidings, poverty, that's never going to leave you. You're taking the path of seeking knowledge, you're going to lose everything you own. Now has become. So the person should know when he wants to learn, the hunger and the drive and the motive, those are going to close on you, obstacles. But as Ibn al-Jawzi said, وَمَنْ تَكُنُ الْعِلْيَ هِمَّةَ نَفْسِهِ فَكُلُّ الَّذِي يَلْقَى فِيهِ مُحَبَّبُ. When your aspirations are high and it's in the sky, guess what? Every pain that you go through whilst you're trying to attain that ultimate goal, you enjoy it. Sometimes you will sit down and you remember a mark that happened on your body. You say, wow, subhanAllah, I remember the scratch. It was a day I was going to a lesson in Sahih al-Bukhari, subhanAllah, I fell down and I slided and it. Qadarullah ma sha'a fa'al, this is what happened. You will enjoy everything. Because you had a drive, you had a, huh? You set yourself a goal and everything that happened, through that course, you'll enjoy it. Poet said, فَمَا حَوَى الْغَايَاتُ فِي أَلْفِ سَنَةِ شَخْصٌ فَخُذْ مِنْ كُلِّ فَنٍ أَحْسَنَ بِحِفْظِ مَتْنٍ جَامِعٍ لِلْرَاجِحِ تَخُوذُهُ عَلَى مُفِيدٍ نَاصِحِ. Two things he mentions. Two things is what, if you want to become a student of knowledge, do you want to learn, brothers? Sisters, do you want to learn? Do you want to become strong in knowledge? Two things is all you need to do. بِحِفْظِ مَتْنٍ جَامِعٍ لِلْرَاجِحِ. Memorize a matn which is mu'tamad. Sit down. Ya ikhwa, if you think you can attain knowledge without memorizing, طَلَبْتَ مُحَالًا. You are looking for the impossible. You are trying to attain the impossible. Allah says about the disbelievers, what did he say? وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَعْمَالُهُمْ كَسَرَابٍ بِقِيعَةٍ يَحْسَبُهُ الظَّمْآنُ مَا. Is this what it is? It's a mirage. You're driving. You think the water is ahead of you. Ya akhi, it's a mirage. It's a mirage. To attain knowledge without memorizing is muhal. It's impossible. So you have to memorize. And now many people are going to say, I memorize. There's many mistakes that people fall into when they're memorizing. The first thing is you're memorizing a matn which is غير معتمد. Scholars memorize books. Don't become a person who says to himself, I'm going to create a new book, a new manhajiyya of what to memorize. Ya akhi, don't. تَرْجُ النَّجَاةَ وَلَمْ تَسْرُكْ مَسَارِكَهَا إِنَّ السَّفِينَ لَا تَجْرِي عَلَى الْيَبَسِ. Are you looking for success? Success is a path. It's got a road. You have to take that path. For example, do you guys know Alfiyat ibn Malik? Have you guys heard of this book, Alfiyat ibn Malik? Alfiyat ibn Malik is a grammar book. It's 1,000 lines written by Jamaluddin ibn Malik, rahimahullah. Yeah? كلامنا لفظ مفيد كاستقيم واسم وفعل ثم حرف الكلم واحده كلمة والقول عم وكلمة بيع. It's a line poetry. 1,000. There's another book called ألفية الآثاري. Have you guys ever heard of that book? I'm sure no one's going to say yes now. That's another 1,000 lines of poetry in مصطلح, sorry, in the same science, نحو. One is متن which is معتمد. The scholars memorize that book. One is another, it's another book, but scholars don't memorize it. It's not known. So when you're memorizing, don't say, you know what, I'm new, I'm going to start, I'm going to memorize Alfiyatul Athari. Ya akhi, memorize the books that the ulama memorize. The scholars, they memorize this book, you memorize the books that scholars memorize. The second thing is when you're memorizing that book, ya ikhwa, look for the best publication. Nusqa, muhaqqaqa. You look for the best publication of that book that you want to memorize. If you're if you're memorizing a book, and that book you're memorizing is a bad publication, what's going to happen to you? So many saqatat are in it. So many letters are missing from the copy that you're using. And ikhwah, when something goes wrong in your memorization, it always becomes wrong. It's hard to get rid of it. The second thing that the line of poetry mentions is what? بحفظ متن جامع للراجح تأخذه على مفيد تأخذه على مفيد ناصحي. You take it to a person who has ahliya, a person who knows the field. You take it to a teacher who's solid and is grounded, and you say, Sheikh, can you read this for me, this book, inshallah ta'ala? I heard you're very good in grammar, you're very well grounded, you know Nahu very well, can you teach me this book? And he goes, no problem, bring it to me. With those two, the person becomes a strong student of knowledge. Now, the last point that I want to say, brothers, is that why are you seeking knowledge for? What's the purpose? What's the purpose that you're learning knowledge for? The poet, he said, فَلْتَقْصِدُ أَرْبَعَةً قَبْلَ ابْتِدَاءٍ لِتَعَلَّمْ لِكَيْ تَفُوزَ بِالْهُدَى أَوَّلُهَا الْخُرُوجُ مِنْ ضَلَالِ وَالثَّانِي نَفْعُ خَلْقِ ذِي الْجَلَالِ وَالثَّالِثُ الْإِحْيَاءِ لِلْعُلُومِ وَالرَّابِعُ الْعَمَلُ لِلْمَعْلُومِ. Four things is why you want to learn knowledge for. If these four objectives and these four goals is not why you're learning knowledge for, then there's a problem why you're seeking knowledge from. فَلْتَقْصِدُ أَرْبَعَةً قَبْلَ ابْتِدَاءٍ تَعَلَّمْ لِكَيْ تَفُوزَ بِالْهُدَى. Four things that you have to come with when you want to embark on seeking knowledge. The first one is أَوَّلُهَا الْخُرُوجُ مِنْ ضَلَالِ. The first one is you're learning to get out of jahl and misguidance. You're learning it for yourself. You're learning because you're sick and tired of being ignorant. Ignorance is a marad, it's a sickness. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what did he say to the companion? Why didn't you ask? إِذْ لَمْ تَعْلَمُوا فَإِنَّمَا شِفَاءُ الْعِيِّ السُّؤَالِ. The cure of ignorance is asking and learning. So the Prophet said the cure, ignorance is a sickness that needs a cure. The first one, the reason you're learning it is for yourself. وَالثَّانِي نَفْعُ خَلْقِ ذِي الْجَلَالِ. And the second reason is you want to benefit the people around you. You want to help your community. You're not learning the knowledge so you can become a bus driver. Yeah, not that I'm saying anything about bus drivers, just in case there's somebody who's a bus driver here. Yeah, ikhwa. I don't want to get stopped when I'm walking out of the masjid, yeah. I'm saying that you're learning the sharia and you're learning the religion. For what reason? وَالثَّانِي نَفْعُ خَلْقِ ذِي الْجَلَالِ. You want to benefit the people around you. وَالثَّالِثُ الْحِيَاءِ لِلْعُلُومِ. The third reason why you're learning it is you want to bring light to this knowledge again. You're reviving the knowledge. Some ulum, ya ikhwa, is died out. People are not studying it anymore. Who can put their hand up today and say, you know, I actually go out my way and I study ilm al-fara'id, inheritance. Or I even study right now mustalah al-hadith. Or I study waraqat, or, you know, usul al-fiqh. Many people can't say that. These are sciences that are really dying out in this era and time that we're living in. That even sometimes when I just use some key terms when I throw in my lectures, people's faces are like... People don't like when something becomes a bit more technical. Last but not least is al-amalu lil-ma'lumi. The fourth reason is to implement the knowledge you know. You're learning so you can implement it. So you can come with amal salih, righteous actions. So ya ikhwati al-kalam, my beloved brothers and sisters, the best of speech is ma qalla wa dalla. That which is small, but that goes, hits the point. And ya ikhwati al-kalam, my beloved brothers and sisters, also don't give up and become lazy. The poet, he said, اطلب ولا تضجر من مطلب فآفة الطالب أن يضجر أما ترى الماء بتكراره في الصخرة الصماء قد أثر. The poet, he said, اطلب, seek knowledge, ولا تضجر من مطلب, and don't become lazy and give up from a goal that you're trying to attain. You want to be a scholar, don't give up. At all. فَآفَةُ الطَّالِبِ أَيَطَّرَى. The greatest harm that a student of knowledge goes through is to give up. أَمَا تَرَى الْحَبْلَ. Some nusakhs, they say, أَمَا تَرَى الْمَاءَ. Do you not see the water? بِتِكْرَارِ. You know the water, it keeps dropping on a rock. فِي الصَّخْرَةِ الصَّمَّاءِ قَدْ أَثَرَى. There's a rock over there. The water is dropping for 2 years. if you look at that rock, it actually affects it. It makes a hole in it. Water that is so light, ya ikhwa, very light, it can affect a rock. How lakin? Bitikararihi, repetition. So if you try to memorize a book, it's not going in. Again, go to it. It didn't go in. Again, you went into it. Bitikrar. You're going to finally get through to the book. And do not give up. I hope my speech was summarized. It was to the point. Any mistakes that I might have come up with, any incorrect speeches or any error, any fault that I might have come with, it's for me a shaitan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanak Allahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.